Yes, films play to our emotion, and I guess everyone of us rooted for the rebels and Jedi, but if you watch it through the lens of logic, you might start to see it, and to hear it from the most tragic victim's own account.
From my point of view, the Jedi are evil!
The Empire was in the right all along. Warning! The following video includes examples of child abduction, mental and physical abuse, as well as religious fanatic indoctrination, culminating in clinically examined severe mental disorders. Also nothing after episode 6 ever happened, except for its comedic mentioning potential and when it solidifies arguments. Period. Also please note that the Empire and so-called First Order are distinct entities. But to keep delivering on what you were promised,
the tragic case of Anakin S.
Whisked away from his loving and caring mother at the age of only 9 years, young Anakin was drawn into the arms and grind of a religious fanatic cult, abject to any display of emotion, with his only benevolent, affection-showing advocate deceased just recently before its actual introduction into the Jedi Order. Being indoctrinated over a decade, young Anakin turned from a confident, self-reliant, one could almost say savvy young man, helping to provide for his household in a very young age, caring about and for complete strangers, going at great lengths for them out of the kindness of his heart, being resilient and downright suicidal, risk-taking, confident in himself. In the span of just a decade, Anakin S. turned into an insecure, impulse-controlled, emotionally unstable, and borderline young man. Seriously, check it out, there have been numerous peer-reviewed articles published about Anakin, the adolescent, displaying 6 of the necessary 5 traits for a clinical borderline diagnosis. Clearly by being traumatized already to some extent, existing as little property to a creature of another species, then being whisked away alone from his established and obviously still somewhat enjoyable life, filled with great affection by his caring single mother, young Anakin got told to suppress all of his emotions, mind, while undergoing daily physical and mental training, as well as extensive indoctrination into religious beliefs, all this as a child and when hitting puberty. Not only this, but obviously for over a decade, he was being denied to even visit his only living family member, let alone having any outlooks to better her predicament, nor being allowed to even think about a family of his own. Until he finally acts against his orders to seek out his mother, feeling she is in terrible pain for months, only to arrive possibly only hours too late to save her life. But it gets worse if we go a little back in time. Although only being 9 years old, Anakin already is considered to be too young for the Jedi's recruitment, while his later mastery of the Force clearly shows it was not for actual reasons like he would have been actually too old to probably get trained in wielding the Force. Although he showed great skills and even greater bravery in many heroic deeds, which got him the recognition and later appointment as liaison officer by the Supreme Chancellor of the Literal Galaxy, Anakin's acceptance into the cult's board of directors was not caused by any of his many achievements, but had to be pressured by the Republic's highest office of the executive. Adding insult to injury, explicitly not even granting the young chosen one the rank of master. Later then, when learning that his, as established highly fanatic, spiritual leaders consider assassinating this highest rightfully elected official and supreme leader during a time of war, and a galaxy in a bitter need of mending, still somewhat idealistic Anakin finally gets disillusioned enough to snap out of his conditioning and do as he was prophesied to do. Instead of a thousands to none, by establishing almost a 2-2 in Jedi vs Sith ratio, as we are led to believe in the prequel trilogy, in the end, he brings true balance to the Force. Anakin from then on does, as he sees, some might say rightfully right for the galaxy, to dissolve the corrupt, self-absorbed, only core systems carrying Republic, with an entity as strict as circumstances demand, if one seeks to bring an order on a galaxy-wide scale. Scarred and ever more traumatized, can you say with absolute certainty that this man is not probably thinking about his mother each time he was able to liberate another village, planet, even people, and ban slavery? To stress the point that the Star Wars movies deliberately play and influence your perception, let's have a look at the intro of A New Hope. We have clear biased framing. When we look at judgmental adjectives like evil empire, of course written in trustworthy capital letters only, the poor brave rebels setting out to save the galaxy from a little Death Star, you are led to see a bad, megalomaniacal, careless fascist state. Yet this state is so inclusive, it does not at all discriminate about its and contractors, for example. An entity even repeatedly ordering to not resort to deadly force, while its standard infantry is obviously rather meant to be peacekeepers, as their massive numbers and decades ago establishing of galactic dominance either allowed for the target practicing to become very lax, or they are so hellbent on trying to give the rebels a chance of giving up Not a single non-Redfat character in the entire movie gets killed by one. There. Now you all know the possible very demeaning presentation of circumstances and another meme possibly rooted in the deepest flaws of perception.
There's one! Set for stun!
He said stun! It wasn't gonna hurt ya! He said stun!
Once more humanitarian ideals being mocked. A place which promotes its grand mosque based on their daring deeds and vigilance, allowing them to rise through the ranks, instead of feeling threatened by a heroic general who for lack of military training does quite well, because they felt he could not yet be more indoctrinated well enough when he was at the age of 9. A place which provides for its citizens, one could say gives them a place to belong. As young Han is an orphan who has to resort to thievery in his greatest need when his life is in danger, the Empire enables him to leave this dire situation, takes him in, and even provides him with a proper last name.
What's your name, son?
Han.
What? Who are your people?
I don't have people. I'm alone.
Solo. Approved. Proceed to transport ID 83 for the Naval Academy at Corita. Good luck, Han Solo. We'll have you flying in no time.
And I dare you to get one of the writers to confirm that there is not somewhere a deeply concerned pension accountant each year hoping Mr. Solo will finally find some stable work to be eligible for his retirement and healthcare plan, only to be blown up with millions of innocent idealists on not one, but two space stations. And yes, you can play the weapon of mass destruction card, but there is strong evidence that possession and singular use of such devices actually deters greater escalation of the opposing side. Naturally, one cannot allow such plans to fall into religious and older nobility elitist radicals' hands. Therefore, in dire times, enhanced questioning needs to be applied. Please see our episodes on all propaganda techniques. With a caring and responsibly taking leader, being present at least to give the poor victim disrespect, while probably writhing in guilt. As we see, rebels who are once captured never set up for execution, as even Vader's grandson then treats his captured enemy with respect for his skills.
I had no idea we had the best pilot in the resistance on board.
And is even concerned about his comfort.
Comfortable?
Next point. The Empire is just not built for war. Let's look at the fighter planes, for example. TIE fighters are very short-range and minusculely armed interceptors, not at all holding up to the interstellar travel-capable 4-gun turrets plus torpedoes-wielding X-Wings. Also, the TIE fighter's cockpit design is so narrow, as we see for example X-Wing pilots using their cabins to get 360 degrees, one could almost speculate that the procurement agency of the Empire is being run by secretly self-sabotaging pacifists. Almost like in the modern German army, where the IFV Puma was made sure to be operable by highly pregnant women. Surely brings some Volkssturm vibes, although at least it's exclusive this time, right? Further, the Empire fires green lasers, which means go and peace. The rebels fire with malicious red, which means stop and blood, lust. I mean, let's just look at the nomenclature of the respective fleets.
A Star Destroyer.
Well, that sounds menacing, but that is the actual intent. As we see in the series repeatedly, they are far away from being able to destroy any planetoid, let alone a star. But think about the impression such a name makes. You think twice about before engaging it. On the other hand, look at the rebels. A Mon Calamari cruiser sounds like an inviting leisure trip with all-you-can-eat shrimp cocktails. It dares you to attack it, to then mercilessly crush you with its formidable weaponry, while their multi-role fighter planes as X-Wings easily keep your own fighters at bay. Further, also whom the rebels associate with gives us a hint. I mean, yeah, bounty hunters might be edgy, but there's a reason these exist in our world as well. And now look at the rebels, whom they are surrounding itself with, and even openly admit it. The Empire is a place which is so aware of its past necessary, yet still cruelties and soul-shattering deeds, instead of eradicating the former cult's memory, they set monuments to the past, showing better, more pragmatic, and less corrupt times have arisen, while giving its enforcers the deepest scarring reminder of their committed atrocities, and why they have to remain vigilant, rooting out the last Jedi, so no one ever again will have to undertake such horrible deeds. Alright, I think, hope, the latest and last point I lost you still, but I'm sure you realized what we have been doing here and what this episode is about. Perception. So you know, Still, if one thinks about it, few of especially the initial arguments are wrong in any aspect. We have a biased introduction, an organization we are supposed to root for. Having such a brilliant military organization, only a member's reference is enough to sit a young religious fanatic with no other credentials into a multi-role weapon of war. The only contemporary organization I could see having such standards would be the Islamic State. But it gets worse. They have no plan. As it is ironic that the separatists work to depose Palpatine, but their own violence ultimately sustained his rule, it is to see how the early aftermath and even the pretext of to the latter sequels presents the state of the New Republic. Once again, the core systems live in a Hunger Games-like central prosperity, while Mando considers it a joke that the New Republic would check on Navarro, while in The Force Awakens, we are once again back to a minuscule resistance with very little to no support until the brilliance of modern writers gave Palpatine an extremely unlikely fleet and basically threatened everyone on a personal level. The highly aggressive Jedi escalated the conflict, and despite General Grievous' death being seen as sufficient by the Jedi for Palpatine to relinquish his emergency powers, he retained them. In their view, if he didn't surrender his powers after Grievous' demise, he should be ousted from office, they argued. However, the separatists were far from being subdued. This brings us to the Jedi, who evidently did not seek actual peace, but control. Recall that also Honorable Mace Windu, a Jedi Master along with several others, sought to execute Palpatine without a trial or conviction, arguing he was too dangerous to be left alive, thus directly violating the rule of law. The Jedi are more than just warmongers. They are irrational and irresponsible. Consider Luke Skywalker in The Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. His training was extremely brief, and he knew he hadn't completed it. Yet when he returned for training in Return of the Jedi, he was considered fully trained, which is a giant logical inconsistency. Clearly, what Luke became was a very dangerous individual with such minimal training. Yet this was always the way of the Jedi. They did this intentionally, instilling violent and aggressive traits in young children, which led to their unnecessary slaughter by Anakin Skywalker. Had the Jedi been responsible and reasonable in their training, all those younglings could have been spared. I mean, just look at it from this angle. Children taken from their families as babies.
How can this be for the greater good?
The greater good.
Shut it! These people died for no reason, no reason whatsoever!
Which is enough real-life evidence how harmful this is. The younglings were indoctrinated into a religious cult, which committed acts of vigilantism, assassination, up to regime changes as they saw fit. The younglings basically were reminiscent of the Hitler Youth, one could say, only with exclusive weapons of war, additionally gifted with uncountable wizardry. While all this, the Jedi's corruption extends beyond this. They distorted the Force, studying only a portion of it, whereas the Sith explore all of its aspects. To comprehend the great mystery, one must study all facets, not just the dogmatic and narrow perspective of one viewpoint. The Jedi prohibit attachment and love, which is not a proven system. Certain real-world organizations and religions also bar their leaders from love and attachment, and the plight of thousands of abused children exposes its flaws.
Truly wonderful the mind of a child is.
The Sith, in contrast, allow love and passion, drawing strength from their emotion, which renders them capable of even reviving the dead. They even believe in teamwork.
Always two there are.
Anakin indeed did bring balance to the Force, by destroying the love and compassion the Jedi sought to eradicate so eagerly. In conclusion, consider the saying, history is written by the victors. These victors clearly are the rebels. Yet while they achieved as much as destroying two Death Stars, with each hundreds of thousands of innocent construction workers just seeking to put food on their families' tables, deeply missing them day by day, as anyone who has ever worked on montage or any kind of external assignment surely can relate to, while enduring cramped living conditions and high-risk work, the Empire didn't simply disintegrate after the Emperor's death at Vader's hands, who was losing his sanity in his final moments, faced with the circle of madness which led him there, now having to fight his own led-astray son. See what I just did? I possibly showed you a completely different, beforehand probably appalling perspective, contrary to your beliefs, intended indoctrination by movies and a complete media culture. So, welcome to the 5th Generation Warfare series, as well as please like and subscribe to the channel to not miss the coming The Devil's Advocate, the Riches Simply Don't Have a Choice episode, as well as part 2 of this one, where we will substantiate all our claims with more actual footage excerpts. Thanks for tuning in, and we hope that you perfuse all being said as well as extrapolate diligently from now on, and that we might welcome you back soon. And to hit the point home one last time, when Luke and friends are captured by the Ewoks, they are planning to have what? Right, them for dinner, while then helping to kill hundreds of Imperials to hold a giant feast in the evening or possibly coming days. So, yes, dear ladies and gentlemen, we reached full Game of Thrones circle and spiced some hint into incest fantasies.
I know. Somehow, I've always known.
With some good old possible heroic cannibalism. All this while the Emperor's shield station is a marvel of minimal invasive construction, protected nature, and obviously having coexisted with the poor primitive Ewoks, whose simple-mindedness was exploited by the rebels, threatening them by playing to their superstition, to get hundreds of the poor fellows killed. Well, but at least...
The flight meat back on the menu, boys!
Take care, and let us know in the comments what you think, you fellow peace seeker or rousing rebellious rascal. Oh, also heavy political warning that coming times of instability might lead to authoritarian leadership being sought, as long as it promises stability and security. Remember this when it comes to. Thank you for your attention, this concludes my elaborations.